Thank you very much. Thank you. So thank you very much. Thank you for welcoming me here. I'm grateful to be with all of you. My children and my wife are in town. That's the good news. The bad news is, and I'm going to tell you this because they're not here yet. My daughters are now 15 and 13, and they have opinions about what they're going to wear. When they were 8 or 9, we told them what they were going to wear. So they're a few minutes behind, but they'll be here. But I'm here, and that's great. And you're going to get to meet them, and I'm excited about it. Thank you for coming out. I'm going to speak briefly for a few minutes, and then I'm going to take your questions here for the next hour. And I look forward to engaging you on the important issues before America. This election, for me, has never been simply a choice between political parties. This election is about the essence of America. This election is a generational choice about our identity, about what kind of country we are going to be in the 21st century. For over 2 centuries, this has been a special country. But that's never been automatic. You don't just wake up in the morning and say, we're American, so everything's going to work out. It has required each generation before us to do what it takes to make and keep America a special country. And now the time has come for this generation to make its choice about whether we are willing to do what it takes to make America special, or whether we are willing to be the first generation in American history that is going to leave their children worse off than themselves. The bad news is that's the road we're on right now. It doesn't have to be. We can change it, and that's the good news. But the bad news is the road that we are on right now is a road that will leave us as the first Americans ever that leave our children worse off than ourselves. The first reason why is because this is now a nation where millions of people feel out of place in their own country as if they're being left behind. Left behind by the economy. The economy's dramatically transformed. Globalization and technology have wiped out industries and jobs that once sustained the middle class. You've seen some jobs go overseas. You've seen people. So now the result is you've got millions of people living paycheck to paycheck, and millions of others who are out of the workforce for the first time in their lives. Record number of Americans no longer in the workforce. These changes have also meant, by the way, that it's not enough to just have a college degree. There was once this promise that if you went to school and you got a degree, you were guaranteed at least a middle-class job. But now it's not enough to have a degree. It has to be the right degree. And millions of Americans don't have the right skills. And what's worse, they owe thousands of dollars in student loans for the degrees they got. When I'm president, we will address these issues. First and foremost, we won't just struggle against the new economy. We will embrace the new economy. We will put in place policies that, again, make America the single best place in the world to create the best-paying jobs of the 21st century. That's why I've put out a comprehensive plan to reform our tax code. That's why I've put out a plan to bring regulations under control called the regulatory budget. That's why I've worked so hard to repeal and replace Obamacare. And while everyone running for president says they're against Obamacare, I'm the only one running for president that has scored a victory against Obamacare because we defunded last year and again this year a bailout fund in Obamacare that has saved you, the taxpayer, $2.5 billion that was going to be used to rail out these funds. We're also going to help people in this country attract the skills they need for the 21st century. For example, I will be the vocational education president. We need more welders and we need less philosophers in America. And when I am president, we are going to make it easier for people as young as 15 or 16 or 17 years of age to go to high school in the morning and trade school in the afternoon. So when they graduate, they don't just have a high school diploma. They will be industry certified and ready to work as plumbers, as technicians, as welders, as pipe fitters, as machinists, as airplane mechanics. These are good paying jobs. And we need to stop telling young Americans that trade school are for the kids that are not smart enough to go to college. Trade school are for the people that want to make $50,000 a year at 18 and 19 years of age. And as president, I will make vocational education easier. And we'll still have four-year schools, guys, because we need college football. So we're still going to have four-year schools. But we can't, it's too expensive. And these thousands of dollars in student loans, $1 trillion of student loans, it used to be higher, but I paid off my loans with my book, An American Son, now available on paper. A monopoly. They will have more competition. And we will make it easier for people that have to work full-time and raise a family to go back to school in a cost-effective way. And we will create alternatives to the student loan. And when I'm president, before anyone takes out a student loan, schools are going to be required to tell you how much people make when they graduate with the degree you are seeking from the school you are attending. before you borrow thousands of dollars to major in Roman philosophy, because the market for Roman philosophers has tightened over the last 2,000 years. The second thing that we're facing is a government that's out of touch. I don't believe there has ever been a time in our history where the government is more out of touch with our people than it is right now. Number one, this is the first generation in American history that's doing this to their kids, saddling them with $19, $20, $21 trillion of debt and hundreds of trillions of dollars of unfunded liabilities. There's never been a generation in American history that's done that. The cost of everything is going up. Everything is more expensive. And yet we have a president that is pursuing radical environmental policies that would make the cost of living in America even more expensive. We have a safety net in America that doesn't even cure poverty. It traps people in poverty. In many cases, the safety net has become a lifestyle, a way of life. And so you have people out there working as hard as they ever have, trying to make it, and you have a government that's actually encouraging you not to work so you can collect government benefits. We are trapping people in poverty, and we are being unfair to the people that are trying to move ahead. We have a world that's unsafe as it's ever been. With lunatic in North Korea with nuclear weapons, the Chinese building up their military, Vladimir Putin and Russia being increasingly aggressive, Iran is going to get $150 billion of sanctions relief that they're going to use to build a nuclear weapon, radical jihadists like ISIS. The world is growing more dangerous. And we have a government that refuses, for example, to secure our borders. And we have a government that is undermining our military capabilities, with cuts to our military that will leave us with the oldest and the smallest Air Force we have ever had, with the oldest and the smallest Navy we have had since the year 1915, and with an army smaller than it's been since before World War II. You add to that the weakening of our intelligence programs and the way we treat our veterans. Talk about out of touch. Look what happens to veterans when they come back to America. They have to wait months to get the treatment they need at the VA. Again, everyone running for president is in favor of supporting our veterans. I'm the only one running for president that's brought accountability to the VA. A year and a half ago, I passed a law that said that if you are an executive at the VA and you are not doing a good job, we can fire you. I know that's for you, but because in any other endeavor in life, if you're not doing a good job, they fire you. And that shouldn't just be executives, it should be anyone. What we will do when I'm president, we will deal with these issues. We're not going to have radical environmental policies. On my first day in office, I will repeal all of these crazy regulations, and we will be a country that fully utilizes the oil, the natural gas, and all of the energy resources that America has that God has blessed America with. We will fully utilize our resources in this country. When I'm president of the United States, we are going to bring the debt under control. We are not going to leave my children and yours with $19 trillion of debt and a Social Security and Medicare system that is bankrupt. When I'm president of the United States, we will finally secure the borders and keep our country safe. And I say borders with an S, because the borders is not just the border with Mexico, it's the airport and the seaports as well. 40% of people in this country illegally overstayed a visa. There is no one running for president that understands this issue better than I do. I have grown up around immigration my entire life. My family are immigrants. My wife's family are immigrants. My neighbors are all immigrants. I live in a majority immigrant community. And we'll have to deal with the other aspects of it that aren't working well. And we'll be responsible with people that have been here for a long time and aren't criminals. But before we do any of that, we must bring illegal immigration under control and secure our borders. And we know what it takes to do that. And this is what we'll do as president. And if I'm president and we have a majority in the Senate and majority in the House, there won't be need for a lot of compromises. We can do it our way. We can do it the right way. And the right way is to put in place a mandatory e-verify system, to put in place an entry-exit tracking system so that we know in real time when someone who came here on a 90-day visa has stayed 91 days or 92 days and beyond. It means adding more Border Patrol agents to the southern border. It means technology in key sectors of the border where we know people cross, like cameras, sensors, and drones. It means completing the 700 miles of wall and fencing already required by law, but that government didn't fund. We will do that. And if we do that, you will see this problem come under control. This is the greatest nation on earth. We are capable of confronting this. And my number one priority as president will be to rebuild our military. We will rebuild our military. We will have a Navy that has sufficient power, an Air Force with sufficient power and technology. We will rebuild our troop levels in the Army. We will rebuild our intelligence programs. And we will have not just the most powerful military in the world for the foreseeable future and for the rest of our lifetimes, but we will have the military power and influence we need to secure the peace. Because history teaches us that weakness. History teaches us that weakness is an enemy of peace. One more point. One of the things I honestly believe we need in order to make sure that government is no longer so out of touch is to ensure that more people who understand what life is like for the rest of us are involved in government. And the best way to do that as president is to put the full weight of the presidency behind a constitutional amendment that puts in place term limits for members of Congress of the United States. The last point I would raise is our perception, our reputation around the world is in decline. The perception around the world today is America is a nation in decline. That in 10 or 15 or 20 years, this won't be the most powerful country in the world. It'll be China or somebody else. And by the way, our adversaries spread that. The Chinese openly say it. America is a stagnant and stale country that's in decline. And our allies are starting to believe that. They are all planning for a post-American world where they can no longer rely on America as being the most powerful country in the world to assist them. When I'm president, that is going to change. From my very first day in office, not only will you have a president that believes that America is the greatest country in the world, not only will you have a president that hopes the rest of the world looks more like America, not America look like the rest of the world, you will have a president that acts like we are the most powerful nation on earth. The other night in the Democratic debate, after they got done arguing over who hacked whose computer, one of the candidates said, we need to be more like Norway. I don't have anything against Norway. Norway looks like a nice place. If you want to be Norway, move to Norway. I want us to be the United States of America, the single greatest nation in the history of all mankind, and we need a president that believes that. So, in closing, let me just say that I know our challenges are real. They are significant. A people who feel like they're being left behind by an economy in a world that's rapidly changing, a government that seems out of touch with what's going on in our lives and has no answers, and in many cases is either tone deaf or making things worse. And the feeling that somehow around the world and even here at home, there is this nagging sense that maybe our best days are behind us. But I want you to believe this, because I do with all my heart. The future of America is up to us. We get to choose which kind of country our children will inherit. And there are only two choices before us. We will either be the first Americans that leave our children worse off than ourselves, or we will leave our children as the freest and the most prosperous Americans that have ever lived. Those are the only two choices before us. And one of the reasons I'm running for president, perhaps the main reason, is because I want my children and my grandchildren, well, my children just walked in. They better, I'm not hoping I don't have any grandchildren anytime soon, but my children are here. This is my wife, Jeanette. Come on in, Jeanette. You guys, come on in. That's Daniella and Amanda and Anthony and Dominick, and they get to see what I do all the time. Yeah. I want them to inherit an America as good or better than the one that I got a chance to grow up in. And you know, one of the things, I just did a radio interview. One of the problems we have is we stop teaching our children for some reason in our schools, in many of our schools, not in their school, but in many of our schools, that this is the greatest country in the history of the world. There's never been a country like America, ever. Almost everyone that's ever lived in a country that said to you, look, you can only be what your parents were. So if your parents were rich or famous, that was good news. If they were like mine, that was terrible news. That meant you got trapped. I was blessed, not just to be an American citizen, but to be raised by people that knew what life was like outside America. And they never had the luxury of imagining that somehow the rest of the world was just as good. They knew America was special. They taught me that from my earliest memory. It's the reason why they came here in 1956. And by the way, my parents never became rich or famous. You never would have heard of them had I not run for office. They never made a lot of money. My father was a bartender. My mother was a maid and a stock clerk and a cashier, all kinds of jobs that paid him just enough to achieve happiness. Because the American dream is not about how many things you own or how much money you make. It is about achieving happiness. And my parents achieved happiness. You know why? Because they owned a home in a safe and stable neighborhood. They retired with dignity and security. And most important of all, they left all four of their children better off than themselves. And what that reminds us is that what makes us a great country is not that we have rich people. We should celebrate financial success in this country. And we do. We don't demonize it. We celebrate it. But every country has rich people. What makes us special is there are millions of people in America who will never be rich, but through hard work, perseverance, and many sacrifices, they achieve happiness. They achieve a better life, and they leave their kids better off than themselves. And now we must choose in this generation whether that's the kind of country we're going to be in the 21st century. And the time to choose it is now. And it is a choice that every generation before us made, and it has never been easy. This country has never had a period when it was easy. It was founded by declaring independence from the most powerful empire in the world. That was hard. Then this country faced a civil war that divided it and almost ended it. Then it had a great world war that cost the lives of millions of people around the world. That was followed by a Great Depression, which was traumatic. And then that was followed by a Second World War that was even worse than the First World War. As soon as the Second World War ended, we found ourselves in a long and dangerous Cold War, where the very existence of life on this planet was at stake. The 60s were a difficult time. You had the nation divided geographically over civil rights and generationally over Vietnam. In the 70s, we had a president that resigned in scandal. We had long gas lines and hyperinflation, hostages in Iran. We even had to confront disco music. These were dangerous challenges. It depends where I say that. Like in New York, people don't like that line. But here, we've always had it hard. You know why we've always had it hard? Because what we have is special. And anything that is special is hard. But that's what we must decide now, whether we're going to do our part. And I believe that if we do, the greatest era in American history lies right before us. If we do what needs to be done, if we do what needs to be done, we can leave my children and yours as the freest and the most prosperous Americans that have ever lived. And the 21st century can be a new American century. And that's why I'm running for president. Because I want this to be a country as good or better than the one my parents left for me. I want this to be a country where people can still do for their children what my parents did for me and what your parents did for you. And that's why I'm here today to ask you for your vote and hope to earn it. So thank you for listening to me. I look forward to your questions. Thank you. Okay. So who has the flags? One, two. So please locate the individuals with the flags. They're going to wave them, and we're going to get to your questions. Yes, sir. I can't see you because of that light. There we go.
I can't see you because of the pole, so it's good. Well, good morning, Senator Rubio. I want to thank you for being here today. My question is, you kind of touched on it earlier when you're speaking on higher education. And I know you have a plan for an income-based repayment system for federal loans, but I went and got my MBA right out of school. Obviously, there was still a gap there that needed to be filled with student loans. My parents worked very hard to give me the opportunity that I had, but it wasn't easy for them to write a $100,000 check to take care of my higher education bill. So what are your plans besides that income-based repayment plan for the federal loans to be able to make those private loans more affordable?
Well, first, we got to deal with the people who have them now, and I think that's where income-based repayment is important. We are a lot of people that today that aren't paying anything because their monthly payment's $500. They can't make $500 payments and because they don't make enough money. And so guess what? They're in default, and that means their credit gets ruined. And student loans are a special kind of debt because you can't get rid of them even in bankruptcy. So they're with you for the rest of your life. I know when Jeanette and I first got married, I think my student loans were well over $1,000 a month. I think it was the single biggest bill we paid. So student loan debt is a real problem. And so income-based repayment means that you're going to pay based on how much you make. The more you make, the faster you're going to pay off your loan. The less you make, the less of a burden it is. It's better than what we have now because collecting $20 a month is better than collecting zero. And at least you're not ruining people's credit. The second is we need alternatives to the student loan. like a student, the student investment plan idea that we have, which allows a promising student, especially at the graduate level where the big chunk of loans come from, to be able to go to a private investment group, and they invest in you the way they would invest in a small business. They pay your tuition. And in exchange, you pay them back a percentage of your income for a defined number of years based on the contract. It's better than a loan because it's not on your credit report. And all the risk is on them. If you're financially successful, they make their money back with a profit. If you're not financially successful, they made a bad investment and they lose their money. But the risk is on them, not on you. This is not an answer for everyone, but it's an answer for a lot of people. And the third is more information. These are bipartisan ideas, by the way. Right to Know Before You Go is a bill that I have filed that as president I will push for and sign. And it is bipartisan. And all it says is that before you sign on that loan, the school has to tell you this is how much people make when they graduate from this school with the degree that you're majoring in. So you can make an informed decision about whether the cost and the benefit add up. And the last is more competition. Colleges and universities in America are basically a monopoly. The only people that can award a degree and accept financial aid are the ones that are accredited by one of six accrediting boards in the whole country. Accrediting boards that are largely controlled by the schools they accredit. I'm arguing that we need to open up an alternative to that, that allows people to get a degree based on what you know. Who cares where you learned it? If you learned it, why do you have to pay a school and sit in a classroom for a semester to learn something you already know? If you serve two tours of duty in the Middle East, doesn't that qualify you for at least 3 credit hours in Middle Eastern affairs? If you're a receptionist at a law firm that's trying to become a paralegal, and you've worked at that law firm for 10 or 12 years, are you telling me you haven't learned anything that we can't give you credit for? That sort of competency-based learning will allow us to shorten the amount of time that it will take to go to school, and it will also make it cheaper because you don't have to pay to relearn or to be taught what you already know. And I would add to that one more point in the competency-based learning system. You will be allowed to acquire learning from a variety of sources. There are some excellent courses available online for free from some of the finest institutions in the world. We should be recognizing that as well. And so technology and innovation has infused every aspect of our lives, except in many cases higher education. We'll change that when I'm president, and that will avoid more people having to take on massive loans and debt in order to finance a college education, often money borrowed to pay for things they could have learned on their own or already knew.
Good morning, Senator. You have a beautiful family. Thanks for bringing them. If you read the medical literature, it states that the number one cause of death in this country is heart disease. But if you look at the real statistics, the number one cause by far is abortion. And last week, the Congress approved a budget that includes funding for Planned Parenthood, which is a leading cause, contributes to many of the abortions in this country. And I understand that one of the reasons they voted that in is because they're worried about shutting down the government, and that will look bad for Republicans. Well, I think that a temporary shutdown of the government is well worth the saving the lives of many unborn children by not giving money to Planned Parenthood. Would you comment on that, please?
Well, what I support is taking the money that's given to Planned Parenthood and giving it to federally qualified health centers across this country that provide health care for women but do not fund these sorts of practices that we've seen across the press over the last few years. Look, I'm pro-life. For me, that's not even a political issue. And I respect people that disagree with me. I have never said this is an easy issue. Okay? I've never said this is an easy issue. This is an issue that puts in conflict two competing rights. The right of every American to choose what to do with their own bodies is in conflict with the right of every human being to live. And I just believe that the right to live trumps that. No pun intended. I believe that the right to live is a... Without life, there can be no liberty. You can't pursue happiness without life. That's why it's listed as the predominant right, life. And if I am forced to choose between two competing rights, I choose life, and I've done so consistently throughout my career. One of the first things I'll do when I'm president is I'll reinstitute a policy that says no more federal funding of abortions overseas. Why is the federal government funding overseas abortions? On the issue of Planned Parenthood, absolutely we should defund them. They raise plenty of money from their charitable contributions that they get and from the services they provide. We should not be federally funding an organization that has been exposed for the sorts of conduct that they're creating. As far as shutting down the government, I've always felt that's a false choice, and it's why this election is so important. The one who's threatening to shut down the government is the president. It is the president who says that unless you pass a law that funds all of my pet projects that the radical left and my party support, unless you fund all of these things, I won't sign it. And if I won't sign it, it'll shut down the government and I'll blame you guys. And I think, unfortunately, congressional leadership over the last few years has not done a good enough job of getting ahead of that argument and making the point that we're going to fund the government, but we're going to fund the things that belong funded. And if you choose not to sign it, it is you, Mr. President, that will be shutting down the government. A year from now, we won't have to worry about that anymore, because God willing, we will have a majority in the House and Senate that agree with us, and we will have a president, which I'm working hard for it to be me, that will sign a budget that does not fund Obamacare, or any, I'm sorry, that does not fund Obamacare, does not fund Planned Parenthood, or any of these other things that we're against.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for being here with us bright and early. If you're president, will you convene a meeting of governments, private sector partners, and civil leaders to mobilize funds in order to deliver adequate nutrition and access to early education for kids living in the poorest parts of the world so that they might have an opportunity to grow to their full potential?
Yeah, I'm familiar with your initiative because we've seen you throughout New Hampshire and other states, and I commend you for being involved in that issue. I have long been a supporter of U.S. assistance programs. Number one, foreign aid is less than 1% of our budget. Number two, if properly used, it plays dividends. And I can give you examples. For example, in the continent of Africa, there are literally millions of people alive because of you. Not just the charitable contributions you make. There are millions of people that are alive today because under President Bush, America contributed to the President's Emergency Fund for Africa for AIDS relief. And today, there are millions of people alive because of the generosity of the American people, and they know it. So in addition to fulfilling that moral obligation, it's not going to be easy to radicalize as anti-American people who know that they are alive because of the generosity of the American people. It was the right thing to do morally, and it was an important thing to do geopolitically. In fact, we are on the verge of the first AIDS-free generation in Africa if we keep moving in this direction. Colombia, where my wife's parents were from, was a failed state 20 years ago. America provided some assistance to Colombian people under the leadership of an extraordinary man, their president, Álvaro Uribe. That country turned it around. Today, Colombia actually does what we did for them. We don't have to. Colombia is providing military assistance to Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, and other nations who are confronting drug gangs that threaten them. South Korea. 40 years ago, South Korea had an economy that was poorer and smaller than North Korea's. Can you imagine that? South Korea, 40 years ago, 30 years ago, was a recipient of foreign aid. Today, South Korea is the ninth largest economy in the world, a strong ally of the United States, and they are a donor state, not a recipient state. This is an example of where U.S. foreign aid has made a difference. And then there are programs where the money's been wasted, where it's been given away and no results and no accountability for it. The program you talk about, what I've told your guys when I've met with them is this. Yes, I want the U.S. to do its part around the world in confronting these issues. I just want to make sure that it's not duplicative of what we are already doing now. And I think my last point that I would raise, and this is in no way against the point you're making, I can tell you the most effective way to eradicate poverty in the world, because the last 20 years of history prove it. It's called free enterprise economics. Free enterprise around the world has eradicated more poverty than all the government spending programs in the world combined. And so, yes, these programs can assist in giving people the skills they need to participate in free enterprise and helping governments create the rule of law necessary for free enterprise to function. But you want to take people from poverty into prosperity? Embrace free enterprise, as they have done in South Korea, as they have done in other nations around the world. And it's one of the reasons why today there are hundreds of millions of people who 30 years ago were starving and now buy things, including buy American services and goods. But absolutely, I think the United States can play a critical role. I just want to make sure it's not duplicative of anything we're doing already now. Flags, you're slipping. Come on.
Hi. To build on your point, Senator Rubio, you said that we have the opportunity for an AIDS-free generation. So the Global Fund has a proven track record of success and has saved 17 million lives since it was established in 2002. As president, would you commit to fully funding the U.S. one-third share of the global fund?
I've actually done it as a senator. It's President Obama who's made those reductions, and I've actually done it as a senator. It's a good investment for America. It's, as I said, it's not the reason why we have a national debt, and we've seen the resources and the impact that they've had. And by the way, as we have funded it, the need has declined because more and more people are healthy and therefore no longer needing of this, in particular in the African continent, which I think always seems to be the continent of the future. And I think this time we have a chance to turn the corner and really create some strong alliances in that part of the world, which is being threatened, for example, in some parts by radicalization. And so our hope is that we can continue to create this, the help them, help themselves, to create not just free enterprise and stable governments, but ultimately strong partnership with us so we can see more South Koreas and Colombias emerge around the world in the 21st century. Yes, sir.
Senator, I am a military retiree and a disabled veteran.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
We want to thank you.
I appreciate what you've said about taking care of veterans and America's promise. Could you please tell me what would be your first three steps in a Rubio administration to fix the VA?
Well, first, we'll have a VA secretary that actually knows how to run the place that will stand up to the entrenched bureaucracy and system. Let me take one half step back. I want to be clear about something. There are really good people that work at the Veterans Administration. There are some really good people there. Many of them are veterans themselves. And so I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about the people that are not doing a good job. And more importantly, I'm talking about an entrenched bureaucracy that is resistant to reform, as all entrenched bureaucracies are. And so I've argued three points. Number one, you need strong leadership. You need to put someone in place that runs that organization, that will not be captive to it, that won't just give up, because you are dealing with people that have been there for 25 or 30 years, whose attitude is, we've seen presidents come and go, we've seen congressmen come and go, we're going to do it our way, and we're going to wait you out. The second thing we need is we need more accountability. And that's why this year I filed a second piece of legislation, which should have passed already, and we hopefully it will, that says anyone at the VA who isn't doing a good job, you can be fired, the way it is in the private sector. By the way, the first law that I passed that allows you to fire senior executives that aren't doing a good job, it's not clear how many people they fired. By some reports, it's only been one person, and that one's on appeal. So it's just not just about indiscriminately firing people, but you can't tell me that in an agency that's failing people, we are giving out more bonuses than we are dismissing people from their jobs. Because it isn't fair to the people that are doing a good job, by the way. The third point is portability. I think the benefit belongs to the veteran, not to the VA. For example, the GI Bill. Does the GI Bill say you can only use the GI Bill to go to West Point, Annapolis, the Air Force Academy, the Coast Guard? No, the VA, the GI Bill is a benefit that follows the veteran. You can use the GI Bill to go to any school or any college or any institute in America that accepts it to provide your higher education. Why isn't VA benefits the same thing when it comes to health care? If you are happy at your VA facility, that's fantastic. Many veterans prefer to go to a good VA facility. But if the VA facility that you are, that is near you, makes you wait too long, or you're not happy with the services you're receiving, our veterans should be able to take that benefit to any hospital, any doctor, any system in America that is willing to see them sooner and get better results. When I'm president, it'll be portable. By the way, I spoke about this 3 weeks ago in Iowa because this is personal to me. My brother served in the 7th Special Forces. He was a Green Beret from 1968 to 1971. He actually went to the Army, came back in April of 71. I was born in May of 71. Just, my parents were very optimistic people. They had kids in the 50s and then kids in the 70s, so whatever. But that was before disco music, you see. And my brother got his teeth knocked in on a jump in jump school. And so they took him over to a local dentist, but they never recorded the paperwork. And so now he needs to go back every 10 years and have work done. And every 10 years it's the same fight. He has to prove to them that it happened as a service-related injury. And he says, well, the only time I ever jumped out of a plane was in the Army. And he's going through this. And it's this appeal process and this constant fight to get through the bureaucracy. You shouldn't have to call a member of Congress. You shouldn't have to get your brother elected to the Senate to get your services done. And it'll change when I'm president. We will be our highest priority to appoint someone to the VA that will bring accountability. We will remove people that aren't doing a good job and replace them or promote people that will, and we will make the benefit portable so that the benefit follows the veteran, not the veteran have to follow the benefit.
Good morning, Does this turn on? Good morning, Senator Rubio. I'm James Trout. I'm a person with Asperger's syndrome, and I work for Respectability USA. We're a disability rights organization based in the Washington, D.C. area. And my question for you is as follows. You spoke very movingly during your speech about the American dream, and there are 56 million people with disabilities, many of whom are veterans, and what would President Rubio do to address the unemployment issue that people with disabilities have? Would you work with private enterprise, state government, local government, et cetera?
Thank you very much. Yeah, disabilities are a very broad spectrum. For example, in an issue like we've worked on when I was Speaker of the Florida House, autism, the spectrum is very broad, from highly functional to people that need lifelong care. Obviously, we have family members or individuals that are facing some of these challenges with their own children and friends that are facing these challenges as well. And then there are other related disabilities that range from Down syndrome to learning disabilities and so forth. And then there are physical disabilities as a result of service or just injury. So it's a wide spectrum. I think the first question on the issue of things like autism, the most important thing that happens when someone is diagnosed is early diagnosis, so you can quickly provide services. You get those first few years. If a child in those early years does not receive the therapy and care that they need, their chances of being functional later dramatically reduced. So it is that quick intervention that's very critical. So one of the things we worked on when I was Speaker of the House is opening up the insurance coverage so that it would include coverage for these sorts of things. But here's the other thing that's frustrating. And that is, a lot of parents live in a community that does not provide a school system that has adequate services for people like that. And as a result, they get stuck in the school system without ever receiving these services. It's one of the reasons why I am such a strong supporter of school choice, especially for children that face disabilities. Parents should be able to send their children to the best setting for them, especially if they have a disability. In Florida, we have a program called the McKay Scholarship, but it's not perfect, because McKay says you have to go to a public school and fail for a year, and then you can use it. So one of the things I've proposed at the federal level is a corporate scholarship fund, which allows corporations to pay a portion of what they owe the federal government in taxes, instead donate it to local, not-for-profit scholarship organizations that give out school choice scholarships, not just for poor or needy families, but also for families of those who are disabled, so they can put their children in a school or a setting, and even if it costs money, that provide these services for them. The other thing we're going to have to look at is the disability fund in America, because there's abuse going on there. And it's unfair to the people that are truly disabled. We have a disability fund in America today that has become, for many people, the new long-term unemployment. It is easier to get on it than to get off of it. And it goes to the point I made about the safety net. The safety net was never designed to be a way of life. It was designed to cure poverty, and we don't cure poverty. So one of the things that I want to see both in the disability fund and in the safety net programs that we use to help people is ensure that if you are on these programs, you are able to fulfill your potential. Now, if you are permanently and legitimately disabled, you may be for the rest of your life dependent. But if you are not, if you are someone that has some capability of providing for yourself, we should be, as part of our safety net program, requiring and providing either education or access to a job, so you can acquire the skills you need to maximize your potential and never again have to rely on government. Today, we don't do that. Today, all our safety net programs do is they treat the symptoms of poverty. They help you pay your bills and buy food and pay your utilities. But they don't do anything to help you acquire the skills you need for a better paying job. So I want to see in both our disability fund and in our safety net programs both a requirement and a path, so that everyone on it is either going to school, unless you're permanently disabled, everyone who's on it is either going to school or working. So you can acquire the skills you need for a job that pays more, and then you never have to be dependent on government again.
The environment is important to people in this country, even if it's not the most critical issue facing us. So in your view, what is the appropriate approach to protecting our environment?
Well, first of all, I would say I would applaud the progress America's already made. Our air is cleaner today than it was 25 or 30 years ago and continues to be. And one of the things that's driving that is American innovators. I believe that American innovation can solve many of our issues. It's one of the reasons why I believe in an all-of-the-above energy strategy, a true all-of-the-above energy strategy. I have nothing against wind and solar and biofuels and renewables and energy efficiency. I want us to lead the world in all of that stuff. I just don't want to artificially pick one over the other. It's one of the reasons why my tax plan allows every business to fully and immediately expense every dollar they invest. So if you're investing $1 million that year to build out a oil-powered facility or a natural gas-powered facility, you get to write it off completely. But if you're investing it in a solar facility or a wind facility, you also get treated the exact same way. And the other is to open up the space for innovation. I do believe that one of the places where government should invest is in basic research. It's why I have a law out there that allows for us to do a better job of commercializing the things that are coming out of our national labs. Because I honestly believe the American innovator is going to allow us to solve some of these issues that people keep bringing up. So, for example, natural gas is a clean source of energy. You know who used to say that all the time? The environmental groups. Why don't we use more natural gas? Until we found natural gas. And now, all of a sudden, they don't want us to use natural gas. You know why we found these deposits of natural gas? Because the American innovator figured out how to drill sideways. We should be fully utilizing that resource and everything else too. So I believe American innovation will allow us to make wind, solar, biofuels, renewables more cost effective. I believe American innovation will allow us to be more efficient in our use of traditional sources of energy, such as oil and natural gas and even clean coal, and nuclear energy, which is another carbon-free source of energy. And I also believe the American innovator will make us more efficient in the use of our energy, whether it's in our automobiles or in our homes. And my last point about energy. Energy is not just an environmental issue. It is an economic issue for the following reason. American manufacturing, one of the highest overhead costs of a manufacturer is energy. The cost of powering that plant is one of the biggest overhead costs of being in manufacturing. If we can make America, from an energy perspective, cheaper to power a plant than our competitors, we can have a manufacturing renaissance in America. We can be an economy that makes things again. And that means millions of good-paying jobs for people who today are stuck in low-paying jobs or in chronic unemployment. These things all work together. I want America to be the most diverse energy portfolio on the planet and lead the world in all of these sources. And I think we can do that in a way that's cleaner and also more cost-effective. But we have to allow the American innovator to drive that, not the American government.
Okay. Good morning, Senator Rubio. Merry Christmas, and thank you for bringing your family.
You.
I'm Ann Kaplan from Portsmouth, New Hampshire.
Thank
My
you,
question has to do with the Iranian nuclear deal and the freeing up of the sanctions that will increase by millions of dollars the flow of funds to Hamas, Hezbollah, parts of the PA. How would President Rubio address arresting this flow in this no longer existential threat to Israel, but direct threat to Israel?
Yeah, I mean, first, the Iranian deal is not a binding agreement. It's not a treaty. It's nothing. It's basically the president. There's an existing law, right? The sanctions against Iran. And in that existing law, like in most sanctions, there's something called a national security waiver, which means the president of the United States can say, I believe it's in the national security interest of the United States to waive the sanctions, not to impose them. So what the president said is, Iran, if you agree to some deal with me, I will waive the sanctions. It's a bad deal. And I've already said on my first day in office, I'll reverse that. We will reimpose the sanctions. Now, the people who think that's a bad idea, oh, you're not going to be able to do that. The rest of the world is already, the train's left the station. We are the train. We are the train. If you tell a major global corporation you can have access to the American economy or you can have access to the Iranian economy that represents less than 0.1% of global capital flows, I promise you I know which economy they're going to choose to have access to, and it's not going to be theirs. I think it's important for our candidates to say what I just said, because if you're thinking about some major investment in Iran, you may want to wait until November of 2016 before you make that decision. Because if I'm elected president of the United States, we're going to cancel that deal on our first day in office. And then we're going to turn to Iran and the world and we're going to say this. You don't need nuclear energy. You're an oil-rich country. If you want nuclear energy, you can have it the same way South Korea and other countries do. And that is, you can import the enriched uranium. You don't have to enrich it yourself. If you try to build a weapon, we will destroy your weapons system. And as long as you're not agreeing to these terms, we will cripple your economy with sanctions. You can have an economy or you can have a nuclear weapons program, but you cannot have both. This is not just important for Israel, it's important for the world. And as far as Iran is concerned, yes, these $150 billion of sanctions relief that they're going to receive, I can give you a long list of what they're not going to spend that money on. They're not going to spend it on global aid for the poor. Okay? They're not going to spend it on disability programs. They're not going to spend it to build more schools and bridges and roads. They're going to spend it on what the Ayatollah of Iran has always spent their money, to sponsor terrorism designed to kill Jews and Americans and anyone who doesn't agree with them. They're going to use it to build up their own conventional power so they can become the dominant military force in the Middle East. They're going to use it to continue to build a long-range missile, which they continue to test and build. You know, there's only one reason. There's only two reasons to have long-range rockets like that. One is to put a man on the moon, which I don't believe the Iranians have a moon program, and they don't claim to have one. The other reason to have a long-range missile is to put a nuclear warhead on it so you can attack America or Europe. And the sanctions don't even cover the missiles. The sanction and the deal does not even cover the missiles. So a month ago, they tested another ICBM. They are getting further and further in their range. And as far as the weapon, guys, they are going to get a nuclear weapon. They're either going to buy it from North Korea, which will easily sell it to them, or they're going to build one of their own. It's not that hard anymore. And the $150 billion are going to allow them to make it even faster. I refuse, and as president, I will not allow us to live in a world where a radical Shia cleric, the Ayatollah of Iran, who has an apocalyptic vision of the future, possesses not just nuclear warheads, but a long-range missile that can hit us here in the U.S. It's not going to happen when I'm president. It will not happen. And it begins by canceling that deal on my first day in office.
Senator, this will be our last question.
I'm going to add one more. Executive decision. This one and one more. How's that? Because I'm having so much fun. Yes, sir.
Senator, I personally come from a Spanish background, and I think it's really exciting to have a candidate such as yourself here in New Hampshire. And it's been determined that a large percentage of Latinos in the country, and even, I believe, 70% of Latinos in Florida, support Obama's opening of diplomatic relations with Cuba and the opening of the embassy. So you talk about moving forward, new leadership. Why not be open to having diplomatic negotiations or relations with Cuba?
Well, actually, I would love for us to have a new relationship with Cuba. But not just America has to change, Cuba has to change. I believe in leverage. I believe that leverage works. For example, it's working in Burma. Not perfectly, but Burma had elections this year. Burma had elections this year because before we recognized Burma diplomatically and opened up to them economically, the United States says, we will provide American relations with you, but you need to take some concrete steps towards democracy. And the result is that this year they had an election, and the military junta that governed the country lost, and now the majority party in their legislature is the opposition, who 10 years ago were all being rounded up and jailed. That's what I want us to do with Cuba. I'm not against changing relations towards Cuba, but it can't be one-sided. And this deal is all one-sided. And why is that problematic? Because Cuba is not just some Cold War relic island 90 miles from our shore. It's an anti-American communist dictatorship. Number one, the Cubans today play host to dozens of criminals who are fugitives of American justice. One of them is Joanne Chesmar, who murdered an American U.S. trooper in New Jersey, a state trooper in New Jersey, escaped from jail, and is hiding in Cuba. And the Cubans are protecting her. Like that, there are dozens of people that have stolen tens of millions of dollars of your money. Medicare fraud. They come from Cuba. Within a year of being in this country, they pull a Medicare permit. They start ripping Medicare off. As soon as we're on to them, they jump on a plane in one of these increased travels that Obama's opened, and they go back to Cuba with millions of dollars. And they live out their life over there in comfort and happiness. Meanwhile, you paying for it. They stole your money. Then the Cubans know this, and they're manipulating that system. There's another problem happening today. We're increasing increasingly in Miami. People are immigrating to the United States from Cuba. They're here in a day. They qualify for a package of benefits, which is extraordinary. Someone who's never worked a day in their life in the United States qualifies for Social Security and Medicare benefits. You know what they do? They move back to Cuba. And their family members every month go and collect the Social Security check and wire it back to Cuba, where these people are living. And who do you think is behind this grand design? The Cuban government is. They're stealing our money by design. They're doing that as well. You know who else the Cubans host? They host the Chinese and the Russians. In the city of Bejucal, the Chinese have an electronic surveillance station, which they use to spy against the United States. NASA, Southern Command, Central Command, Special Operations Command, all headquartered in Florida, the Chinese spy on us from Bejucal, Cuba. and lure it to Cuba, the Russians have a listening station that does the exact same thing. The Cubans are the third or fourth most active intelligence agency operating in the United States. You know why they spy on America? Because they sell our secrets as a commercial product to other nations. You know the Cubans last year, about a year ago, were caught smuggling weapons to North Korea in violations of UN sanctions? So my point is, of course, let's change relations to Cuba, but there's got to be reciprocal. They've got to make some changes too. And my argument is the president gave them 50 things the Cubans wanted. You know what the Cubans did? Nothing. On the day that the Cubans announced the deal over a year ago now, they announced we are freeing, I think it was 57 political prisoners. Do you know the majority of them are already back in jail? Do you know that every Sunday there's something called the Ladies in White, which is a group of women dressed in white that after Catholic Mass march down the street every Sunday now for multiple years. You know what happens to them as they're marching? They're spit on. They're punched. Many of them are arrested. They're beat up. They're harassed. The Cubans aren't going to change a thing. My only argument is if you're going to make a deal, get something in return that's good for our hemisphere, that's good for the country. We have a migratory crisis from Cuba. Since we signed the deal, the number of people escaping Cuba has skyrocketed. There are thousands of Cubans today stuck in Costa Rica because they're trying to come up Central America, cross the border, and into the U.S. What's driving this migratory crisis? The Cuban government is. So my point is, yes, let's change relations to Cuba, but we got to get something in return that's good for the Cuban people and good for America. And that's not what this president got. Like every deal he does, it is a disaster. It is one-sided. And I'll reverse it, and we'll make it work. Our last question. To come all the way to New Hampshire to get a Cuba question. I love it. Yes. Yes, sir.
My pleasure being here, Senator. My,
thank you. My honor that you're here.
I fundamentally believe in smaller government, and you spoke about reducing the debt. The budget that was just passed, I believe, is a couple thousand pages, hauntingly echoes
2007 pages.
Okay. Yes. Hauntingly echoes
with
of
no
we had
pictures,
to pass
no
it.
No pictures.
Hauntingly echoes of we had to pass it to find out what's in it. Your thoughts in the future as far as reducing the size of government, reducing debt, without taxing us beyond belief.
Yeah. Well, first, reducing the size of government means reducing its authority. There are all kinds of things the federal government's involved in. It was never designed to get involved in. I can give you one right now, K-12 education. There's no reason why the federal government's involved in K-12 education. We don't need Common Core. We don't need a national curriculum. We don't need a national school board. We don't need a Department of Education. So this is an example. But the way the federal government grows is largely through the regulatory state. They write regulations, and for every additional regulation, you got to hire more regulators. And so one of the things I proposed is a regulatory budget. Well, this is the way a regulatory budget will work. It's the same as a monetary budget. It limits how much regulations can cost our economy. So we would lower it substantially from what that number is now, and then we would cap it. And what that would mean is if the Employment Prevention Agency, the EPA, if the Employment Prevention Agency wants to write a new regulation that costs $1 million to comply with to the economy, they're going to have to cut a regulation that's worth $1 million. So it keeps it from growing. And as we shrink it and then we cap it so it cannot grow. Now, you talked about the debt. 30% of our budget are things that are covered in the bill like what passed last week. It's called discretionary spending. We can decide how much or how little we want to spend on defense, on roads, on bridges, whatever. 70% of our budget is driven by Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, and the interest on the debt. That's called mandatory spending. We don't get to decide how much we spend. We are required by law to spend whatever it costs. That is what's driving the debt in the long term, is the way that is structured for future generations. I come from Florida. There are a lot of people on Social Security and Medicare in Florida. I believe in these programs, and I support them. My mother's on this program, both of them. They are critical to her. And my mother cannot afford for those programs to be changed on her. And the good news is we don't have to. We don't have to change anything negative. We don't have to disrupt her Social Security or Medicare. We don't have to disrupt the Social Security and Medicare of anyone who is on it now or anyone who is about to retire. But our next president better be someone who tells you this truth. And that is Social Security and Medicare, there is no way it looks the same for me or for my children than it looks now. There's no way. It either will go bankrupt or we will reform it. And what are those reforms? There's nothing unreasonable. Instead of retiring at 67, I will have to retire at 68. If I were still in the Senate, I would be among the youngest people there, okay, at 68. Medicare, if I've been financially successful, if I've made a lot of money, my Social Security benefits are not going to grow as fast as they grow for someone who made less money. And my Medicare could very well be the option of taking my Medicare benefit and using it to buy a private plan that I like better. Again, these are changes for people like me, 44 years of age, 30 years away, 25 years away from retirement, and my children even longer. We don't have to change anything for the people that are on it now. And if we do that, we can bring our debt under control in respect to the, how big it is compared to the size of our economy. We can save these programs. And we don't have to disrupt anything for the people that are on it now. If we wait another 5 or 7 years, I don't think they can make that promise to you. There better be a sense of urgency, not just about the debt, but about saving Social Security and Medicare, because they are going bankrupt. They, Social Security in particular was designed when we had 16 people paying in for every person receiving a check. Now it's down to 3 people paying in for every person getting a check. It will soon be down to 2 people paying in for every person getting a check. The numbers don't add up. And these people who go around saying, we're not going to change anything, all we're going to do is raise taxes on rich people, they're lying. That doesn't work. It doesn't do enough. So we need to be serious about that. It brings the debt under control, and it allows us to save these programs. That's what's driving our debt. That's what I've been talking about since 2009 when I ran for the U.S. Senate in Florida, a place with a lot of retirees. That's not well known, but there's a lot of retirees in Florida. And that's what I'll do as president. It better be among the top priorities of the next president. The next president of the United States is going to have to spend political capital on this issue early in their presidency. Otherwise, this will turn into a crisis. And I'll close with this. I do not believe the next president of the United States can serve 2 terms without addressing this issue. This will blow up on us, one way or the other. Because if the interest on the debt climbs to just a normal historic figure, we're going to be spending more money servicing the debt than we are on our own military. And that is unacceptable. So I'm going to stick around and say hello to all of you in person. I want to thank you for coming today, and I look forward to seeing more of you. Thank you. God bless you.